In the day's other headlines, wildfires raged across southern Greece, and the tragedy deepened when a tanker plane crashed, killing the two pilots. These fires come as temperatures there pushed back above 104 degrees Fahrenheit. Emma Murphy of Independent Television News reports from the Greek island of Corfu.
With one natural resource, they seek to save another. Scooping water from the sea to douse the flames engulfing the land. Fires now threaten thousands of hectares in the north of Corfu. Record high temperatures, tinder dry land, and the suspected work of arsonists now leaving lives, homes, and livelihoods in peril.
Are we safe here? Is it close enough?
I was from this side up. Now the wind, look, the wind changed. So that's the danger thing. When we become stronger, like, that's not good. Yeah, when comes a wind, and now the wind comes to us. Yeah. So the flames are here behind, the flames are there, so.
In Lafki, it was meant to be the village festival tonight. Now they just hope the village will be saved from the flames. As the flames encroached, more villages were evacuated.
There's nobody there. We took them all.
Those caught in the path were taken to safety in nearby towns. Even the animals were gathered up and moved away.
Scenes like this are being replicated across the island, where police are closing roads because fires that were previously under control have been whipped up by the wind. It's the middle of the day here, and it already feels like it's going dark, but that's because of the smoke. And there are constant flurries of ash coming down.
The heat wave across parts of Europe and North Africa has had a devastating effect. In Algeria, it's now been confirmed 34 people have died, including 10 soldiers involved in rescue efforts. Meanwhile, in Italy, Palermo Airport was forced to temporarily close when fires came too close for it to safely operate. Elsewhere in Palermo, fire crews were tackling a blaze dangerously near to one of the biggest hospitals. Patients were evacuated as the flames approached. Temperatures are expected to remain high for the next 36 hours as efforts to contain their impact continue.
That report was from Emma Murphy of Independent Television News. In Israel, the ongoing backlash over Parliament's vote to weaken the country's Supreme Court was on full display today. Full-page ads of black ink covered major newspapers with the message, "A black day for Israeli democracy." And thousands of doctors walked off the job in protest for a 24-hour strike.
Tomorrow, the physicians will go back to work, but I can say that thousands of them are not going to be silent, because there is a strong feeling, including myself, that we cannot work as physicians when Israel is no more a democratic state.
Israel's military also acknowledged today that more and more military reservists are asking to be excused from duty as a form of protest. Meanwhile, new violence erupted in the occupied West Bank. The Israeli army said its troops killed three Hamas gunmen in a shootout near Nablus. China today removed its foreign minister, Qin Gong, with no explanation. He's been on the job for less than a year and was an outspoken defender of China's increasingly aggressive foreign policy. Qin had disappeared from public view almost a month ago, and the Chinese foreign ministry has issued no comment on his removal. Russia has rejected new calls from the United Nations to reinstate the Black Sea grain deal. Moscow pulled out of the agreement last week, cutting off exports of food products from Ukraine. In Brussels today, European Union officials discussed how to ship that crucial grain to nations that rely heavily on it.
The decision on the part of Russia, the use of food as a weapon of war, is absolutely intolerable. The consequences of the closure of the Black Sea route a few days ago pose a problem for the output of grain from Ukraine, but also for international markets.
Separately, the UN's nuclear watchdog reported that landmines have now been spotted around the Zaporizhia nuclear plant in southern Ukraine. The site has been under Russian control since shortly after the war began. Back in this country, UPS reached a tentative deal with the Teamsters union, likely averting a crippling strike. On any given day, the company ships about a quarter of all packages in the U.S. If ratified, the five-year agreement will mean higher wages for workers and air conditioning in delivery trucks, among other things. Legacy emissions for children of university alumni are under new scrutiny. The Education Department said today it will investigate whether the policy at Harvard is biased in favor of whites. It's the latest fallout from the Supreme Court decision against affirmative action in admissions. Bronny James, the oldest son of basketball superstar LeBron James, is in stable condition this evening in Los Angeles after suffering a cardiac arrest. The 18-year-old collapsed on the court Monday during basketball practice. James ranks as one of the nation's top high school point guards, and he's committed to play at the University of Southern California this fall. The Biden administration today issued new proposals to expand insurance coverage for mental health care. They'd require insurers to assess whether there's equal access to mental and physical health benefits and take remedial action if needed. The proposals are subject to public comment before being finalized. And on Wall Street, stocks made modest gains ahead of tomorrow's Federal Reserve action on interest rates. The Dow Jones Industrial Average was up 26 points to close at 35,438. The NASDAQ rose 85 points. The S&P 500 added 12. Still to come on the NewsHour, President Biden designates a national monument to Emmett Till. Republican presidential candidate Vivek Ramaswamy discusses his run for the White House. Steph Curry reflects on his remarkable basketball career and the new film that documents his rise, plus much more.
This is the PBS NewsHour from WETA Studios in Washington and in the West from the Walter Cronkite School of Journalism at Arizona State University.